tienen las flores, llorona, las flores del camposanto. No sé qué tienen las flores, llorona, las flores del camposanto. Que cuando las mueve el viento, llorona, parece que están llorando. Que cuando las mueve el viento, llorona, parece que están llorando. Ay, de mi llorona, llorona.
I'm Brittany Conley. I teach Time 103 at Portland State University in the Core Art Program, and I'm here with the wonderful artist Patricia Larsen in Mineral de Pozos, Mexico, and also Frankie, our star Frankie here, just this beautiful pup. And we are going to talk a little bit about the curation of Patricia's space, her artwork, her process, the process of collecting, and how that kind of finds a way into her artistic practice. And so happy for you all to join us. Patricia, do you want to talk to us a little bit about your process? Like, what kinds of objects you tend to make, if you have a medium in specific, or if you kind of just go with the flow, depending on how materials speak to you?
Or what materials appear.
Yeah.
Because quite often it depends on if I'm walking, you know, down the street and I find a branch or a rock or a piece of metal. I'll bring it back to the studio and it'll more or less say make me into something. So I love clay. I love dirt. I love mud. I love the possibilities that it offers, like from growing, you know, a potato to making a beautiful pot, or throwing it on a wall and making a surface. So I love doing clay and ceramics, but I also love using that on surfaces, like such as this. I'm sure it's probably got some mud and dirt somewhere underneath the layers.
When you started talking about like using it in different possibilities, like growing a potato, like the idea of dirt and then actually turning it into a pot, it makes me think about the sort of history of that material. You know, like it's like time is in that material. Like it's either in the ground.
Culture.
Yeah, totally.
I mean, a museum anywhere in the world, and they have the most primitive handmade pots to the very sophisticated pottery, really intricate. And it's like, it's magic, because it's a hunk of dirt. And to be able to spin that into something, you know,
using just your body. Yeah. Not even really advanced tools at the time, you know.
Often just hands.
Yeah.
And again, it's about saturation, because you're actually... Your energy is so into that material.
Yeah.
It's creating it.
Yeah, and we walk on it, we exist on it, like this earth is full of it.
We put it in our face.
Yeah. That's so interesting to think about. That essence of time that's kind of in your process, this idea of collecting. I know we were talking the other day with Drew about you going to all these places antiquing and collecting and finding things from these junkyards. What is it about those pieces, like that patina that kind of happens over time, that lifespan that already exists, that really speaks to you? Because a lot of your objects that you collect, their surfaces have been, you know, like the door in the other room, the surfaces have been highly, you know, beat up, or you can tell that time has kind of weathered it and changed it.
I think what really attracts me to an object or a person or music or food or anything is possibility.
Yeah.
I love the possibility of seeing a great form with great lines and like sometimes it's just enough.
Yeah.
And sometimes you just want to add that or subtract from that. But there's always these possibilities. And I think my artist's mantra is what if.
Like, yeah.
What
yeah.
if I take this off and add this on here?
Yeah.
What if I leave it out in the rain for 6 months and cover it in dirt?
Yeah.
I'm
going to ask you a hard question then. When is something finished? If it is, because I know we talked about this piece and you might just continue to work on it, you know?
It's a good question. One time I had a piece in a restaurant and it was up for maybe about a month, and I looked at it and I was like, oh my gosh, that background is the wrong color. So I went home and grabbed my paint and I came, and people were sitting in the restaurant and I just painted it up the back.
While
so
it was hanging?
Sometimes, yeah, while the restaurant was open, and I just like immediately was like, this can't be this color any longer. So a lot of times it's just a spontaneous, it's just annoying. It's like, sometimes it takes a while to go, this isn't quite finished. It hasn't experienced enough.
Yeah, yeah. Do you come across an object and it's already has its full potential?
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah.
It's
yeah.
like a complete piece in its own crazy mixed up inside out upside down way. Mexico is so diverse.
Yeah.
It has the ocean, it has the mountains, it has desert, it has beautiful gardens and places where they grow beautiful olive trees, and this place kind of has it all except for the ocean, which doesn't interest me as much as dirt, so it's fine. But I love that you can see olive trees, there's vineyards, and then there's like cactuses, and there's minerals. Minerals, even saying minerals makes my mouth water. So I hope to do a lot of clay here using a lot of the local dirt.
Oh, cool.
And primitive fires really interest me more than a glaze that sits on top of the pot.
Yeah.
Again, I want that smoke.
To really absorb into the material. Like it becomes part of it versus a surface out of sorts.
Yeah,
is really,
a surface. I think that's also why I like working on canvases that have plaster or anything that's absorbent, because I like that that it goes inside and then you erase it. Like I do a lot of scratching, adding, scraping, leaving it out in the rain, bringing it back, yelling at it, hugging it. Just really
there's definitely
it's a
some
battle. It's
kind
of, it's not where I go to relax.
It
isn't? No.
It feels so relaxing in here, you know? Like, it feels like, I mean, just like coming in here, you just feel, and we'll show the space in a minute, but just the essence of you as an artist is like embodied in the in the entirety of it.
But there's a battle to get there.
Yeah. Has it taken, when you were a younger artist, do you see such a transition, like, in your career? Like, have you seen yourself kind of move in different directions or leave things behind that weren't serving your practice that, you know, that you recognize now?
I think the things that I've left behind are more emotional.
Mm-hmm.
Like, there's no one way to do it. There's no one correct way to do it. Isn't maybe it's never finished. Maybe it is. So it's not so much in the materials.
Yeah.
I remember when I think I realized how I was an artist when I was about 4, and I traded my Christmas doll for the neighbor's kid's watercolors, and then I just painted snow all day. Like, that's what I was interested in.
You were like, that's it.
From the beginning. Like, I'd rather, be in that, in the creative process of things, rather than receive a finished.
A finished object. You want to be part of the construction. Also, I wonder, like, on those paintings, snow all day, you know, were you precious about the end result? Or do you feel like you were constantly renegotiating?
I was so fascinated by the color. Like, I love color. And everyone says, why do you love color? Everything is so monochromatic, white, gray, beige, stone, bone, you know. But I do love colors. Like all the colored lights last night, that just thrills me.
Yeah.
Right to the bone. Like I love that. But so I think as a kid, I was just so happy to be making
something.
Yeah, making colors. Like coloring Easter eggs.
Yeah.
I'd color the Easter eggs and then I'd spend hours just mixing all the watercolors.
It's so fascinating that excites you, but it feels almost like you've encapsulated the city, you've brought it in through sort of the roughness kind of existing in Mexico, but it does feel a little bit like the snow here, you know, because we're surrounded by this, these beautiful nuanced whites and sort of these just raw materials. And there is a sort of absence of color. Or it's like you've taken an experience of white and just kind of expanded it because you've got these beautiful neutrals and these sort of nuances in the wall. There's just like such a study of that singular color and so many different formats and textures and possibilities.
And a lot of that's created by nature.
Yeah.
It's like wind, sun, rain, elements, wind.
Yeah.
Erosion.
Yeah.
So I think a lot of the color in this town is from the...
From that. Yeah,
from,
totally.
From the elements.
Totally.
And
then,
yeah.
Yeah. Huh. A little bit about this work. You know, your experience of making it, what materials you use.
This piece is a more recent piece where I was really experimenting a lot with stains. Pouring and stains.
Are these wood stains?
So yeah, some of them are wood stains. Some of them are things like tea, instant coffee, anything available that's around me. Because that's when I always say, what if?
Yeah.
Like, what if I just throw some instant coffee or make some of these stains? And what if I put some bleach on here and took some of this color off?
I like that you don't limit yourself to, you know, art making materials.
I'm totally irreverent when it comes to materials.
Yeah.
And I seldom use like acrylic. I'll use mist tints from Home Depot.
Yeah.
I'll use like coffee. I'll smear dirt into it.
Wow.
You know, so a lot of it is kind of not about, and that started like just not having the funds to buy acrylic.
And then you're like, what can I do? What's the possibility of this object?
Lipstick,
polish. Is this wax here? Is this just like corn wax?
So this is just clear white glue.
Oh, cool. Oh, it's beautiful. It almost looks like wax.
Where I pulled it off.
Yeah.
And left, you know, different layers, different stains.
Yeah. I love how, too, when you're talking about that sort of saturation, you know, this surface up here that's like, sort of at relief is like changing the way that we experience what's behind it, you
right.
know?
And it's again, it's like knowing when to stop.
Yeah, knowing
that,
when to stop.
Yeah, it's not so much knowing when it's finished, just knowing when
yeah.
to stop.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. That's a problem I have.
This piece, again, is stained. So
tell us how you negotiated this piece. What are the materials in it? You know, how did you decide when you were finished? Are we looking at all stain or?
Basically, I painted this when I first moved to San Miguel.
Yeah.
And I just had this big empty space. And usually when I move, I don't bring a lot with me. So I had the stretcher. I usually paint on board, but I had canvas made. And so I just used what was available, which was black shoe polish, coffee. And just like,
how did you get these red and oranges? What is this up here?
That might be a little colored chalk.
Colored chalk in there?
Kids, little like sidewalk chalk.
Oh, how cool.
Brought into, I can't remember because I did it quite a while ago. I know that this purple line is colored chalk.
Colored chalk.
And what? Then splashing some bleach into it.
Yeah, it almost looks like a darkened sunset, like when night meets day or something like that. What's nice about this is like because you're not using traditional acrylics or traditional materials, this will obviously change over time still, right?
Yeah, it actually has, it fades out a bit. I don't very often frame pieces.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not sure why I frame this. I like the edges to be part of the...
Part of
I think once they're framed, they become objects, like decorative objects.
Yeah.
And without the frame on there, I think
they more existed as raw material.
A un santo Cristo de fierro lloró mis penas, le conté yo. ¿Cuáles no serían mis penas, llorona, que el santo Cristo lloró? ¿Cuáles no serían mis penas, llorona, que el santo Cristo lloró. Ay, de mi llorona, llorona de un campo lirio. Ay, de mi llorona, llorona de un campo lirio. El que no sabe de amores, llorona, no sabe lo que es martirio. El que no sabe de amores, llorona, no sabe lo que es martirio.
Well, Patricia, I think our students can learn a lot from you, and I really appreciate you
I hope so. Yeah. I hope that I remember being a student. And is there life after school? And there is.
There
really is. Like, once you, like, probably most of your students were artists since they were kids. Like,
And then they're just figuring out how to negotiate what that is for them.
Right.
Do you have any advice? Like, okay, last question, I swear. But do you have any advice for students? Like, what you would say would be something that you learned as an artist to really...
I learned to say yes.
Yeah?
I learned to say yes if somebody said, would you put your paintings in this coffee shop?
And you'd just say yes.
Yes. I didn't ever think, oh, I'm too good for the coffee shop now because I had a show in New York.
Yeah.
I just said yes to everything. Would you donate a painting for Art for Life?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yes. Yeah.
Because I knew that was a way I couldn't maybe give them $3,000, but I could give them a painting for that much. So I think just saying yes to all possibilities, not being too judgmental.
Yeah.
Just keeping open and being generous of spirit.
Oh, I love that. Thank you so much. Thank you for saying yes.
Tápame con tu rebozo, llorona, porque me muero.